This is English shorthand dictation number 217 and the dictation speed is 140 words per minute. Ready? Start. Mr. Chairman, sir, the point which Mr. Smith made was with regard to the technical personnel ordinance. He said that this technical personnel ordinance has in it the principle of inequality of treatment between employer and the employees. The point that is sought to be made out there was that under the technical personnel ordinance, an employee is not free to resign from his employment, while under the same ordinance, an employer is free to discharge an employee. Sir, I should like to state the true position as may be found from a reading of this ordinance. The true position is that an employee is not required to obtain permission of his employer if he wants to resign. What is required by the ordinance is that he should ask permission of the tribunal if he wants to resign. On that point, I think Mr. Smith is somewhat misinformed. Then, sir, with regard to the power of the employer to discharge, the position is that as a rule, he is not allowed to discharge or dismiss an employee unless he has obtained permission of the tribunal. There is undoubtedly one exception, and the exception is that in case of insubordination of misconduct which calls for disciplinary action, the employer may dismiss his employee without obtaining the permission of the tribunal. Now, sir, I do not think that this particular provision, which permits an employer to get rid of an employee who has misconducted himself or who is insubordinate, can be a ground for complaint. In the way in which our industry is organized, it is the employer who has the right to dismiss a worker who is of no service to him. Therefore, I think there is no point in that. But what I wanted to inform the House and Mr. Smith particularly is that in order that there may be no abuse of this provision, we have amended the ordinance in two important particulars. The first thing that we did, and that was done expressly at the desire of Mr. Smith, was to constitute advisory committees to be associated with the tribunal. On these advisory committees, there are representatives of labor, and I have no doubt with the help of these advisory committees, they will be able to bring to the attention of the tribunal such cases which arise due to victimization. The second and the most important step which has been taken is this. We have now issued an order calling upon the chairman of the tribunal to place on record his reasons for not allowing an employee to resign from or to quit his job. This is a provision which we have borrowed from the Criminal Procedure Code, so that at the center of the government, it would be possible for us to know whether there were legitimate and proper grounds for the chairman of the tribunal not permitting an employee to resign from his job. Mr. Smith has also pointed out that the conditions in coal mines were not very satisfactory. I do not claim that the conditions are ideal, but I do like to say that the Labor Department has taken definite steps to bring about better conditions in coal mines. We have been running our coal mines with two types of labor, local labor and the labor which we have imported from outside, principally from the Gorakhpur district of Uttar Pradesh. There are 20 officers under the Chief Inspector of Mines. In addition to that, we have now appointed a Chief Labor Commissioner at the center. Under him, there are 3 Deputy Labor Commissioners who will be in charge of all the welfare activities. Mr. Smith said that the Labor Department was always behind time in taking action. On this point, what I would like to submit is that in the circumstances in which we are carrying on the activities of the Labor Department, delay is inevitable. We have got to consult the provincial governments. We have got to consult the organizers of labor. We have got to consult the employees. All this must necessarily take time, and therefore I do not think that there is any point in Mr. Smith saying that we delay matters. Sir, since December last year, when the ban on women working in underground mines was first withdrawn, there has been a consistent protest throughout the country against this undesirable action. The government of India is fully aware that it has not only violated an international pledge, but that it has considerably shocked and offended world opinion. A year ago, at the request of All India Women's Conference, I moved an adjournment motion asking that the ban be reimposed immediately, and my honorable friend, who spoke on a cut motion on labor during the budget session on the same subject. But the plea of the honorable labor minister at that time was that this was a very temporary measure, only to be carried on till the next harvesting season and not for the period of the war, that arrangements were being made to remedy the labor shortage, and that once these arrangements went through, the ban would be lifted. Sir, the attitude was that we were creating all this song and dance with about nothing, since the period was to be very short. A year has come and gone, and today I think the attitude has become far more adamant. The Honorable Labour Minister has made it clear that he does not intend to reimpose that ban. The Honorable Members of this House are only too well aware of all the circumstances and realize fully that if the arguments which have been put forward had come from a merciless type of capitalist employer, they could have been understood. But it is beyond our comprehension how they could have been ratified and even advanced by those who are primarily responsible for the protection and the well-being of the common people. Sir, I should like to have the support of the House, because this is a legitimate demand, and the infringing of this demand leads to the infringing of one of the most elementary canons of human decency. Sir, with regard to this cut motion, it is difficult to deal with it adequately within limited time that is at my disposal. I would start by saying that the last time when this question was debated on an adjournment motion, I made the statement that I felt very unhappy about the decision which the government of India has taken. But the circumstances are such that it is impossible to take any other action than what we have taken. It is unnecessary for me to tell the House that the coal cutter is a prime mover in the process of producing coal. It is no use having a very large labor force in the coal mines if you have not got a sufficient number of coal cutters. Coal cutting is the primary activity. This is the crux of whole problem, that this important class of workmen has decreased very fast. The reasons why these coal cutters have decreased are well known to the House. In the areas where the coal mines are situated, there were tremendous possibilities opened up by various industrial establishments, military works, and alternative employments, where wages were considerably higher than they were in the coal industry. The alternative employment had also the advantage that it was the work on surface, which is undoubtedly far more attractive than the work underground. The third reason why the coal cutters preferred to quit the mines in favor of the other employment on the surface was because the coal cutter could take his wife along with him and get her earnings added to his own, and thus increase the family earnings. If he worked in the mines, he could not benefit of her earnings because of the ban. This was probably the greatest inducement which the coal cutter had in alternative employments that were within his reach. Now, I have no doubt that nothing else would have helped to bring back the coal cutter except to allow his wife the opportunity to work with him and earn a wage. In my judgment, nothing else could have enabled us to retrieve the position and get back the coal cutter into the coal mine. We have been told that we could have got back labor to the coal mines by increasing wages.